Now, how would you like to have a superpower? A superpower that could solve most of your problems and of those around you. A superpower that would allow you to multiply time and convert your dreams to gold. I'm talking about engineering, of course. A superpower that until recently has been reserved only to those who have gone through years of university training and got into companies with huge manufacturing capabilities and there got lucky enough to be selected to the glorious research department. But nowadays, if you have an idea that could help people, you can go to companies like Kickstarter and propose it to the whole world, and if people find it useful for them, they might fund your product, and you don't have to go to those companies like before in front of the managers that wouldn't have nothing to do with the end user, ask them to run a test batch of a couple of thousand units, market it and sell it for you. In 2009, I went to Japan. I was expecting to be greeted by robots there, get my meals done by them and all sorts of things like that. But what I noticed that daily life there is not much different than here in Lithuania, and robots being closed behind factory doors and in universities being developed by a rather small community of researchers. I thought to myself, why not try to encourage growing a community like that in Lithuania? Why not try to implement that superpower which we have the means already to use? So in 2010, with huge help from Solius Vasilauskas from the Baltic Orbis, I started the School of Robotics, Robotikos Mokykla. Mykolas, fifth grader at the time, was given a task to help disabled people. So he made a model of a robotic arm and got covered himself up in sensors, all kinds of that could measure his chin movements, eye movements, and stuff like that. And by that, he was able to program that robotic arm to move with moving his face muscles only. Our students have presented their ideas to Kaunas University of Technology's professors, and rightfully so. The device on the left you see is a power generating, a model of power generating device that would gather electricity from temperature differences of day and night. Žilinas and others like him have outrun university, technological university students in line following competitions with robots like this that would go like 4 meters and faster per second. A team of fifth to seventh graders, Rokas, Gediminas, Juozas, and Mikalojus, were given a task of improving food consumption. And what they have independently noticed was that we don't actually get fresh fruits or vegetables at our supermarkets, because a fresh fruit or vegetable is considered only if it's been picked no later than 24 hours before our buying. And what they decided to suggest was a greenhouse controlled by robots entirely and put on top of supermarkets. So we could kind of buy our fruit and vegetables straight from the garden. Matas has won the first place in RoboCup Junior Dutch Open in the Netherlands this spring. His robots were competing in soccer matches against robots from other countries. Right. Students, we are given a task to create robots that can walk by themselves. Those robots would be able to learn to walk by themselves using the most capable algorithm ever invented by nature, that's evolution. They would gather 20 individuals into one robot, which would then try out all kinds of different moves with their legs, and those who would move furthest would be selected to mate in between and even mutate, and by that they would learn how to use those legs to move further and further, and some of them even learned how to cheat the system by moving the sensors that were measuring the distance. So, what I've noticed out of those examples that my students have showed me was that you need three components in order to grow an inventor, at least those three. That is immersion, directed creativity, and capable tools. By immersion, I mean getting surrounded yourself by problems and solutions that are similar to those you are solving. One of the easier ways to do that is to train your idea muscle, just like you would train any other kind of muscle. Try and find a problem in your daily life that you could find any kind of solution, no matter how stupid, but just write a problem and, well, a couple of solutions. The one in the background is a tent that's in the shape of some famous building and a texture like that, that I drew some in an exercise like that, a doorknob that would turn on the light when turned. Those kind of things will probably never be made, but it makes my idea muscle trained for the one problem that needs to be solved. Creativity, just like any other instinct, can be directed and must be directed, because you don't create from vacuum. And that's being done very successfully in art schools all over Lithuania, while I don't think we have a shortage of great artists here, and that's quite successful with the sports schools as well, as we can see from the international sports championships. But imagine, and you don't even have to imagine, just remember what you can get if you start teaching kids to solve real problems from a young age, direct their creativity to that kind of problem solving instead of, well, what's being only done right now. And the last thing I've noticed that you need for that is a right tool. Because if you give a kid a tool that he can make an actual working thing instead of a pen and paper and ask him to create a future spaceship or a future school or a device, then you might be surprised to find out that he can actually make that thing. And if being at this kind of task for many years instead of just starting out at university, well, it would be unbelievable what kind of problems we could solve. I had an opportunity to use this muscle of mine, this idea muscle last summer when Andrews from a Norwegian company, Graphic or 3D, approached us and asked for a robot that could make 3D pictures which you could see without any need of glasses through a special lens. So we made a robot that would track a predetermined point in space with an accuracy of 36,000 points around the circle. Here you can see the robot in action among Norwegian mountains. This spring, we had a guest at our facilities. Vaida wanted to feel a robot for the first time, and being blind from birth, with our help, she was able to construct it and was very happy to feel this moving thing that could feel with the sensors, the light, the distance, the sound, well, doing things that even she couldn't do. And she asked then, could we make her a robot that would allow her to navigate space so that she could go shopping without a need to ask for a friend to lead her? And well, I said to her, well, most probably in 10 to 15 years, considering the advantages of technology, the Google self-driving cars, you will be able to get a tool like that. But after some thinking, I thought to myself, well, it might be possible that we could do that kind of tool ourselves. And this summer we have applied for a patent to a device that you could feel the buildings in the distance, the traffic going around you, and possibly maybe even mountains in the horizon. So I would like to leave you with a request. Train your idea muscle as often as it's possible, and because we need your ideas, we need your solutions to the problems, because only solving them together, we will make this world a perfect place. Thank you.